Good morning, Delaware. You are now tuned in to this week's previously recorded worship services from the East Zion Fair Baptist Church in Wilmington, Delaware. Wilmington's most exciting church.
Yeah. brothers and sisters. I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How could you see your life was the only gift I'll ever need to be free? It's amazing with you. I win even if I lose. Everything's working for my good for always.
Come on.
I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and say welcome to the East Zion Fair Baptist Church, Wilmington's most exciting church, the church that love ya and anything you can do about it. It is a joy, it is a privilege to have each one of you who are worshiping with us today. I know for real, that you could have gone to any church in this city, but you took the time to worship with us today, and we consider it a personal privilege and an honor to have you with us. I pray that something is said or done that will literally transform your life. We want you to walk out of here knowing this, that we love you and ain't a thing you can do about it. Come back and visit us again. But until that time, know for today that you are welcome, welcome, and welcome.
Welcome. Welcome. Welcome to East Zion Fair. We've come here today to give him all the praise. We welcome you to East Zion Fair.
Good morning, East Zion Fair family. Here's this week's announcements. Our Warriors in the Word Zoom Bible Study is every Thursday at 7 p.m. The Bible study starts with praise and worship, which will prepare you for the study of God's Word. Our National Prayer and Meditation Call occurs every Sunday and Wednesday morning at 5 a.m. This is our time as a people of God to hear an encouraging word and pray for miracles in every aspect of our lives. Join our National Prayer and Meditation Call directly dialing 319-527-2650. Sunday school is held every Sunday at 10:30 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Join us as we explore the fundamentals of our faith. Prayer is key to our access to the Lord. Join us every Wednesday for our noonday prayer at 12 noon in the sanctuary. We're back for our in-person live worship celebrations in the sanctuary every Sunday at 9 a.m. and 11:30 a.m. There's power being in the presence of the Lord. Join us weekly as we worship together at 9 and 11:30 a.m. every Sunday morning. Join us at 9 a.m. on YouTube and Facebook Live by typing East Zion Fair Baptist Church. There are four ways to give at EFBC. 1, through Cash App using $EFBC 1992. 2, through Zelle, trustees at EastZionFairChurch.org. 3, by mail, 1400 Beach Street, Wilmington, Delaware, 19801. And 4, through the website by MyEastZionFair.org and click the giving button. If you are in need of transportation to the church, please call the church by Friday at 5 p.m. You must be able to provide proof that you are fully vaccinated and do not have a vehicle of your own. To schedule a pickup, call the church at 302-652-9114, extension 110.
Oh, is Jesus. Pray with me today. Eternal and all-wise God, our Father, giver of every good and every perfect gift. God, we bless you. God, we thank you. God, we adore you. And God, we love you. Not because we've done something right, but because your grace and your mercy continues to find and satisfy every need in our lives. And God, we say thank you. And now, God, we come to this moment when the word of God is going to be proclaimed to the people of God. I pray, God, you would hide me behind the cross of Calvary, that I won't glory in myself, but that I'll glory in you and your word, that somebody can be healed today, that somebody can be delivered today, that somebody can be set free today. Have your way, God. Have your way, God, in the name of Jesus. Somebody came in the sanctuary today and they were hurting, but you're the healer. Somebody came in seeking and you're the one who can make everything found. So God, have your way. And we promise you, God, we'll give you all the praise. We'll give you all the honor. And God, we'll give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Go with us to the book of 1 Kings chapter 17. We're going to continue one more week. It's been 15 weeks we've been in this one series entitled, Lord, Make Me a Better Me. Amen. Anybody getting help through what we're trying to do? Amen. Amen. I got an email this week and it just blessed my life. If you're here, I appreciate your email. One of our newest members sent me an email and said, Pastor, I was just complaining all the way to church. And I said, Lord, I need a word from you. And Pastor, when you announced your subject, that was my word, stop complaining. See, that's when you know the Lord is working, amen. Go with us to the book of 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 18. I mean, verse 8 rather through 14. And we just gonna try to talk to you for a moment and get out of your way. In the book of 1 Kings, chapter 17, verse 8 through 14. Listen to what it says. Then the Lord said to Elijah, go and live in the village of Zarath, near the city of Sidon. I have instructed a widow there to feed you. So he went to Zarephath. As he arrived at the gate of the village, he saw a widow gathering sticks and he asked her, would you please bring me a little cup of water? As she was going to get it, he called to her, bring me a bite of bread too. But she said, I swear by the Lord your God, that I don't have a single piece of bread in my house, and I have only a handful of flour left in the jar and a little cooking oil in the bottom of the jar. I was just gathering a few sticks to cook this last meal, and then my son and I will die. But Elijah said to her, look at this now, don't be afraid. Go ahead and do just what you said. But I like this part. For all of y'all don't understand the way God works, let me read the first part again, because I don't think you got it. He said, she said, listen to her talk. Listen to her talk, Dr. Hahn. She says, I only have, she's talking to the man of God, I only have a handful of flour left in my jar and a little cooking oil at the bottom of the jar. I was just gathering the sticks to cook the last meal. The last, somebody say the last meal. My son and I will die. Now listen to the man of God talk to her. Don't be afraid. Go ahead and do just what you said, but make a little bread for me first. Then use what's left to prepare a meal for yourself and your son. What a selfish person, somebody is probably saying. Verse 14 says, for this is what the Lord, the God of Israel says, there will always be flour and olive oil left in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the crops grow again. I love that verse in 12. It says, I swear by the Lord your God. And verse 13, he says, don't be afraid. Make a little bread for me first. In verse 14, he says, for this is what the Lord says, the God of Israel. There will always be flour and olive oil left in your containers. Today, as we continue this little series, all I want to say to you is trust God to provide. That nothing big, nothing deep, nothing sophisticated, because I learned when I get too sophisticated, y'all don't catch it. So I'm just gonna give it to you straight. I dare you to say to your neighbor, neighbor, learn to trust God to provide. Now come on, touch yourself real quickly as we make this declaration to ourselves. I will trust God to provide. Come on, let's celebrate the Lord together. Giving is fundamental to the character of God. Being that God is the creator and owner of all, everything belongs and is subjected to him, which means God has the primary and complete claim on everything and everybody that is. Psalms 24 reminds us that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. In 1 Corinthians 6:19, Paul makes it clear that he says that we don't belong to ourselves. We've been bought with a price. And therefore, here it is, we belong to God. Here's the crux of the matter, Brother Chris. God owns us, and everything we possess comes from God, is sustained by God, and is subject to God. Oh, that's the whole sermon all by itself. Whether we're in abundance or in scarcity, God loves us and lends everything to us, all for us to fulfill his purpose and to carry out his plan. For all of you who's so stingy and tight and don't want to let go of nothing, it don't belong to you. It belongs to God. He gave you the new car. He gave you the new house. He gave you the new business so you can be a blessing to somebody. And nowhere, I'm gonna preach quick and get out of your hair today. And nowhere is this truth telecast and tackled more tenaciously than in the text that I've tagged to teach on today. In 1 Kings chapter 17, it talks about a powerful prophet by the name of Elijah, who came on the scene after having a big argument and confrontation with a king by the name of Ahab. He proclaimed to Ahab right in his face, living in his house. He says, as the Lord God lives, before whom I stand, there shall neither be rain nor dew to fall on the ground unless I say so. But let me talk to you for a moment. Listen, immediately after the prophet of God proclaimed this, Lance Watson, I got to give him credit. He said participation, or should I say rain, it went on protest immediately. God shut up the heavens and there was no rain. It got a little fuzzy for him. So God instructed him, the prophet Elijah, to leave Ahab's palace, then to live in Cherith, and which was a wilderness in the wild. God instructed, his instructions to Elijah was, go and he would give him water from a brook and supply ravens to feed him. Now here's the problem, Dr. Hines, that I'm having. Ravens are wired to flee from places that are plagued by drought and famine, because they are consumers and not contributors. But God, who is the owner of everything and everybody, has the liberty to shift. Oh, I wish when I was writing this message this week, I was excited, because when I looked at what God was doing, it emancipated me. God, who is the owner of everything, he shifted the nature of the raven and said, instead of being a person who takes from, I want you to give to. For every person who's stingy up in here today, God didn't bless you, God didn't heal you, God didn't deliver you so you can sit back and talk about what you got. Everything belongs to God. Elijah took God at his word. He took him at his word. And as a result, Reverend Wilson, every morning and every evening, ravens served him and a brook simply supplied him. But then there's a trouble that's coming. Then the text said that the brook dried up. Let me help somebody real quickly. No brook in our lives is meant to last forever. Because God blessed you with something doesn't mean it's gonna last. Listen. You may want to ask the question, why would God give me something that ain't gonna last me forever? Here's your answer. So you will never praise the provision over the provider. You ain't got to help me today, because I came rested up and I'm feeling good today. God wants to make sure he supplies your every need as you need it. And if you think because you sitting high today, you gonna always be sitting high, no, there will be a moment where you gonna have to go back to the same God. Do I have anybody in here today who know what I'm talking about? God blessed you over here and God blessed you over there, and before you turned around, you needed something else from. Thank you, Brother James, but I ain't nowhere near there yet. When the brook dried up, God said to the prophet, watch this, because with those of you who sitting still ain't doing what God tell you to do, watch this. Well, listen to this. He said, I want you to head north to Zarephath. I have commanded a widow there to feed you. Now, this ain't Bible study, so I can't get into this part, because it would take me all day. But it's obvious if I could just cut around the corner, because if I stay there, Dr. Hines, I'll have to tell you, widows ain't had no money. Widows ain't got no prestige. Widows didn't even have a man to define them. How you gonna now send me to something that can't help me? Let me tell you, God may not make sense to you, but I dare you to trust him. I wish I had one person in here who know what I'm talking about. I know it don't make sense to you, but it's not about making sense to you. It's about you trusting God. Look, Elijah's trust was rooted in God. Because listen, all of God's instructions were against the norms. Y'all sit down, because y'all messing me up. All of them were against the norms. Ravens, we're gonna serve you. Ravens don't serve nothing. Brook is gonna set. It's a famine of rain. How's a brook gonna serve me? And now a widow who wasn't from among, well, I didn't even say that part. Wasn't even from among his kinsmen. A pagan woman. Talitha, you with me? Look, a pagan woman gonna feed you. In Israel, Elijah had a place and position, but Zarephath was a Phoenician city. It was a part of the territory of Jezebel, where the people didn't worship Yahweh, but they worshiped Baal. I'm just trying to give you the context, which meant God was sending Elijah beyond the barriers of his comfort zone. Let me help you, Sister Mars. Let me help somebody. God will make sure he does his best work when you're out of your comfort zone. God sent, watch this, a Hebrew to a Phoenician, because despite of the divisions in human that humans create, every place is equally owned by God. For all of y'all who can't stand this one and can't stand that one, and you worried about how God is gonna bless you, God is in control of your enemies as well. He'll cause your enemies to bless you. He'll cause your enemies to speak well of him. God is not, I'm trying to preach a little sermon here, Deacon Bird. God is not, anybody listening to me today? God is not limited to time, to space, to conditions, to classifications, or to environment. The old saints used to sing it this way. He's got the whole world in his hand. But God sent Elijah to a foreign place to be fed by a pagan god. Can I tell you why? To prove his sovereignty. He proved that I can make a raven change his nature. He proved that I can make a dry brook give you water. He proved that I can get a woman who ain't got no status to feed you. Somebody say, God is sovereign. Someone say it again, God is sovereign. Listen. When Elijah, I'm almost at my point, my questions. When Elijah arrived, the widow was gathering sticks to build the fire. He asked for something to drink. Think about it. He was traveling. The brook had dried up. I'm thirsty. God knows how to even handle you. You can't ask for what you ain't craving. I ain't mean to go there. That wasn't in my notes, but I need somebody to know that God has put a craving in you. It's time to ask for it. But wait a minute. When he arrives there, the woman stopped what she was doing and she gave him a drink of water. While, can I put it in my own form just for a minute? While he was sipping, not on gin and juice, but while he was sipping, he said, hey, would you bring me a piece of bread? Now, I want you to pay attention to all you Bible scholars to something that I just caught recently. When he asked for water, which was an open supply, she gave it to him. But when he asked for something to eat, which she already had a plan, sometimes God will mess up your plans. She said, hold up. Wait a minute. I was cool with you getting a little water. But now you're messing with my son and me. And I already got a plan. And my plan is not to give no old greasy Jerry Curl wearing preacher. Oh, I'm sorry. She spoke up. She said, as, let me read what the text says, because y'all don't like my commentary. She says, surely as the Lord your God, I don't have a single piece of bread in my house. All I have is a handful of flour and a little bit of oil. I was gathering the sticks to cook our last meal. Somebody say last meal. So my son and I could eat it and die. This woman clearly recognized and understood her predicament. And based on the facts of her circumstances, she placed her trust in her circumstances. The subject today is to put your trust in God. Watch the difference. Elijah kept stepping everywhere God told him to go. When he gets to this Phoenician widow, she decided, hey, you done went too far. Now you messing with my plans. If you want God to bless you, let go and let God. I can't say it no better. I was looking for the most eloquent way of saying it. Stop holding on to your dead plans when God has a living moment for you. You've been trusting horses and chariots, but they get tired. I dare you to put your trust in God. Can I get, before I ask my question, can I get one person who can tell me the truth? Don't fake me out and don't lie to me. That yes, Pastor, there was a moment in my life when I had to put my trust in God. It didn't make sense. I didn't want to do it, but I recognize the sovereignty of God. I recognize that if God couldn't do it, it could not be done. Do I have one witness in here today? Here's the question. When the facts of our circumstances are unmistakable, where should we place our trust? Slow it down, brother pastor. Do it again. When the facts, stuff you can prove, stuff you can see, of our circumstances are unmistakable. I see the drought. I see the hurt. I see the lack. Where should you put your trust? First, in the person of God. Come on, tell me right back to me. Say, in the person of God. Y'all look like y'all going to sleep real quickly. Say, in the person of God. Look at verse 12. I'm going to break this one down and I'm going to get out of your way. I swear by the Lord your God. The word she uses for Lord is Yahweh. This is the covenantal name of God. The name God reveals to Moses out of the burning bush that would not be consumed. Even though she was a foreigner to the faith, God wasn't a foreigner to her. She said to Elijah, as the Lord your God, she acknowledged that Yahweh was not only living, but that he was also personal. Your God. Y'all ain't catch it. I caught it this week. Your God. Anybody know him as your Savior? Listen. He's your power. He's your strength. He's your authority. He's your sovereignty. She had no personal relationship with the Lord yet. Now don't scream yet. Yet she submitted to the reality of his personhood. Here it is, but not to the sovereignty of his authority. Oh, I'm going to make you shut up real quickly. She says in the text, I like this preaching. I have just enough for a last meal. We're going to eat it and we're going to die. Her hermeneutic was, y'all know that word. Y'all all right with that? Okay. Her hermeneutic was, I have just enough. Her hermeneutic was, see, I got all these preachers in school, so I gotta let them know I might be the young buck, but I got it together. Her hermeneutic was, we're gonna eat it and die. But watch this. God is both sovereign and omniscient. God sent Elijah knowing that this widow struggled with both his divine authority and with her own scarcity. One would think that Elijah would have recanted and allowed this poor struggling widow to make her last cake, eat it, and die. That's what you probably would have thought. Oh, she's struggling. She shouldn't pay her tithing. And I don't even preach like this. For all you on the pastor, don't preach about money. But I gotta give you the truth right now. Oh, I know. I got to pay the electric bill. And I only got enough for the electric bill. So, Lord, you understand. But Elijah was committed to her living and not to her dying. He saw her surviving the present plague and not perishing in her present predicament. I ain't finished. Elijah understood, Deacon Burke, that everything that is seen is not everything that is. Elijah didn't recant. He said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go and do as you said. But first, make a small loaf for me. Then bake one for you and your boy. For this is what the Lord." I can imagine in the 21st century, if Pastor Curry came to your house and said to you, "I need something to eat," and all you really had was just enough to eat what you had and die. And then he with his old big old fat self talking about, "I heard what you said, but I don't want you to pay attention to what you said. Make something for me first." Boy, I can hear the cuss words. Lord have mercy. I can hear the, I can see Facebook posting, "You won't believe, oh my God." But Elijah said, "I want you to do what you said you're gonna do. But I need you to give me one first." Elijah was audacious in his ask, and he was courageous in his challenge. Because regardless of what he saw and felt, his responsibility was to directly speak the word of God into her situation. Elijah understood, despite of her scarcity, that everything belongs to God. Ezekiel 18 and 4, it says, "All lives are in my hand, says the Lord." In Romans 14 and 8, it says, "Whether we live or die, we are the Lord's." So whatever the Lord tells you to do, don't second guess it. Know that if he gave you the opportunity to do it, just do it and watch him provide. Our calling and command is to put our trust in the Lord. Life will drop us in many different places, but we are the Lord's, and I'm so glad that I'm his, because every need that I have in my life, he will supply it. And another reason why I'm glad I belong to him, because he's not like my family. He's not like my fickle friends. He's not like church people. One day they're with you and the next day they're against you. But the God that that I serve, the God that I trust, he never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Because he's sovereign, he knows exactly what he wants to do, how he wants to do it. So our job is to trust him to provide. Trust him to provide. But then there's a number two. Not only must we place our trust in the person of God, but we must also put our trust in the provision of God. Let me give this to you real quickly. In verse 13, it says, make a little bread for me first. God will always provide, but provision, there's a provision that comes with his condition, with a condition. In order for God to provide, we must release what God is asking for. All too often, we spend our time saying, God, I need, as if he's a consort, always giving us everything we need. But what are you giving back to God? It's not only about money. It's about our time. It's about our talents. It's about our treasures. The problem is we just want to take from God, heal God, deliver God, set free God, make a way God, do this God, do that God. And God says, slow down for a moment. What are you doing for me? In order for me to bless you, you gotta do something for me. Do I have a witness in here? We're receiving by releasing. With this woman only seeing her scarcity and expecting only death, God attached his provision to her participation. She was required to first, somebody say first. She was required to first surrender to God what she currently had. God promised her a continuous flow, but the key to unlocking it was for her to surrender what she already had. Oh, preach, Pastor Curry. Which means we give back to God, not because God wants to take something from us, but because God wants to give something to us. Stop believing that all the church want is your money. The devil is a liar. You sitting under a pastor who don't preach those sermons about give on the financial side. But today I got a word from the Lord. Being stingy is why you in the predicament that you in today. When you learn how to release and let God. You so worried about if I don't hold on to this and I don't hold on to that, in hard times I'm gonna fall apart. But the same God who took care of me yesterday is the same God who will take. Listen, with God the issue is never about abundance or lacking. It's always about priority. Somebody say priority. With little or with a lot, God claims priority over it. God simply says, make me first. As much as I want to just hum and get through this part, because I'm uncomfortable when I'm getting in this area, but I got to give it to you today. God is saying, make me the priority of your time. Make me the priority. Some of y'all never late to work. Pastor, look, Pastor, I got a reward. Pastor, I got a reward. Been on the job for 30 years and ain't never missed and ain't never been late. And every Sunday we see you tipping in with that Holy Ghost finger. I ain't trying to start nothing. Listen to me. It's not about what you have or don't have. It's about making God priority over it. Do I have a witness in here? It's about making sure that God is the one who's getting the glory out of what you have. not yourself. Because remember, the brook dried up. You don't want to be in a place where God is not talking to you when your brook dries up. Oh, I ain't gonna get no help in here. Listen. All this woman could see was death. Her outlook was constricted by her circumstances. But then the prophet showed up and said, "Don't be afraid." His perspective assured her that she was tied to a greater reality. That's good stuff. And therefore, despite of her circumstances, she didn't need to be afraid. Sometimes people of faith see what you can't see. You so edumacated, you so got so much going for you that you think you know everything. But listen to me, sometimes God works out of the unordinary in order to bless your life. Elijah challenged her, watch this. Elijah challenged her to hold on to the belief that God would make a way for her. He simply says, make the Lord first. And that's what God is saying to us. Make me first. I don't care what you do with the second, the third, but make me first. Proverbs 3:9 says, to honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything that we produce, then he will fill your barns with grain. Malachi 3:10 says, bring all the tithing into the storehouse, then he will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out blessings that there shall not be room enough to receive. Jesus declared in Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all those other things will be added to you. In Luke 6:38, it teaches us to give. Then you will receive, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. Listen to me very carefully. When God calls upon us to release, it's because he has something for us to receive. You getting this word today because God says, I'm ready to bless you, but you holding on to what you already got. You cannot, watch this, y'all. You cannot get anything in a closed hand. Oh, look at my hand. How can you put something in there? You can't get nothing out of a closed hand, but it's when your hands, Lord, I'm available. Jesus, the only, see, when you decide that I'm going to make it my business to release all I have to the Lord, it is then the Lord will bless you. Stop trying to hold on to your own talents and your gifts. Let God arise in your life and let God be the one that is priority.
You have been watching our previously recorded broadcast from Wilmington's most exciting church.